Sesame Street Live has been around a lot longer than Harry Potter, One Direction, and the misguided Imagine of Looney Tunes from 1996 and 2000 and 2021. But there have been over 40 productions in Sesame Street Live, including spin-off tours, and the fabled Road Trip Stage 2 from 2019 produced by Feld Entertainment. Anyways, there are so many great tours over these 40 fantastic years, but I've been quite fond of a few, and they have a close place in my heart. So let's get on with the countdown without number 10 show. And so I'm here to set the record straight which show is the best, and which one is the worst. I'm probably going to go by the 30 already existing shows that are on the Sesame Street Libicky, plus it would be exhausting to rank each individual version of the production, so let's get it started with our first section, a section that has to do about a certain grouch and the shows that make me almost as grouchy as him. Number 30, Let's Dance. If Into the Magic is the rise of Skywalker of Disney on Ice shows, Let's Dance is the rise of Skywalker of Sesame Street Live shows. First of all, there's no existing story. It jumps from place to place, starting with Elmo conjures the power of imagination, then with Bert isn't hip, then we're playing games with Count and friends, and then the rest writes itself. Secondly, Bert can dance. Bert has danced a lot before. I would have made the plot mean Bert doesn't feel like he's hip and cool with the kids, instead of Bert won't dance because he can't, and the I won't dance number doesn't really help in my case, so stop lying Sesame Street. The only good numbers are Bale, New Way to Dance, and Elmo's Got the Moves. But a lot of content comes from theme park shows and Out of This World and Ready for Action. Also, the human hosts were completely unnecessary and add nothing to the actual show except stop it when a story is starting to be established for a completely unnecessary dance party. And there was way less Big Bird than Make a New Friend, Count was barely there, and Oscar was completely absent. Also, the Murray and Grumjay to switch up is really awkward. I know he wasn't on the show as much at the time, but seriously, he's more relevant than Grunjecta. To the people who suggested I review the show, I luckily haven't seen it in person, so there you have it, my thoughts on this storyless, legacy character destroying, excuse of a show. Number 29, 1, 2, 3 Imagine with Elmo and Friends, and the 2002 reboot. I think you're surprised I ranked this so low, but not really. It's an overall disappointment, especially since this is the 30th anniversary production of BEE's 100th tour, showing how low the company stooped when it comes to the usual tours. Elmo's World was okay in 2002, but completely unnecessary in the 2009 version, especially since Marky isn't in the show. Abby took all of Zoe's lines, Zoe became understudy while Roxy Marie spoke, which might be fulfilling if you're a fan, but in terms of keeping the show relevant, not that much. The video screen sucks, Elmo's World is mediocre, the steam heat replacement is excellent at best, and a lot of the interesting elements from the original 1996 and 2002 productions are gone. At least Grover had two lines, that was a nice addition. Number 28, Elmo Makes Music. Elmo Makes Music. Hearing Frank Oz, Jerry Nelson, and Carol Spinney perform together is a treat for fans, and special since this is a remit of a show that's old but also new. That's the only nice thing I have to say about this remit. This is marginally a better revival than January 2nd, 2003 Imagine, because it does have real sets and not some lame video screen. Anyways, this show is pretty boring stat-wise, too much street and not enough scene change. The songs are memorable, especially since most of them are classic songs from the television show. I wish Zoe would have spoke instead of Baby Bear, but in staying in the show speaking wise is okay. What else is there? They changed Disco Bird to avoid copyright, which fulfills Disco Bird's wish of saying no to commercialization. Abby was okay, but in honesty, did Elmo need to make music 14 times? As much as I prefer the VSTAR shows, at least Feld Entertainment keeps things fresh by doing different shows for Sesame Street Live instead of remounting the same show over and over. Can't say the same thing about Disney on Ice. Number 27, Out of This World. Out of This World. I think it's a cute premise, the yippee Martians visit Earth to learn about Earthlings. But it felt like a staged episode. When I go to these kinds of shows, I think the shows that try to do a new concept are superior to those that try to recreate the magic that can be found on television. I think most of the song choices were lame, with the exception of everything from Attitude Dance all the way to Disco Duck. The original songs were fine. Happiest Street in the World is a great song, but I feel like there's a lot holding this show back. Number 26, When Elmo Grows Up. His is one of the better revivals, but a lot was taken out of it, including Cookie's Drive-In number, Telly's baseball number. In addition, for lame additions like Elmo's World and Baby Bear replacing Roxy Marie, at least that changed in the theater circuit tour. The only good additions was Cookie Monster's firefighter number recycled from Let's Play School, and Abby Kadabi making her way downtown walking fast, Faces Pass and Homebound in a hilarious parody of 8,000 Miles trying to practice our magic. But there's a lot of the memorable moments that were kept, like Rosita's Spanish lesson, Grover's crossing guard number, I Love Trash, most of Big Bird's role in the show, especially for a show called When Elmo Grows Up, contrasting their dynamic, which I think is a really strong one in the production. Number 25. Big Bird Goes Hollywood. Follow That Bird is a heartwarming film. It's got a great cast. It's got a great message. The performances by each character is phenomenal. Counting the credits is the funniest example of meat humor, and I think it's a much better film than Elmo and Gretchenland, because Follow That Bird feels like a film. This show promoted the film. I think the premise of the show was a silly one. Guy Smiley won a movie studio and has to make a feature film in an hour, with these two brokers trying to sabotage the efforts of the gang. I love the concept, the little opening bit that's on YouTube, but its reason for existing is a pretty basic reason. I think there's another major issue with the show. Act 1 is longer than Act 2. I think Act 1 should have ended with Count's castle and everything else could happen in Act 2 to balance it all out. But it's a bizarre way to promote a film, but the movie-making concept is really wonderful. Number 24, Sesame Yumbori. I feel like this show's storyline can be described as weak, but the premise, interesting. I like that all the characters do get Western outfits. The show is centered around a Western-themed concert. The Blue Fur Mountain Band or Okay, I Refuse to Sing Along is one of Sesame Street's greatest songs, but I think the novel idea can get pretty old if done way too much. If I learned anything from Tony Award-winning musical Curtains, featuring David Hyde Pierce, Western musical are the lame ones. Number 23, Can't Stop Singing. This show takes inspiration from an actual episode and feels way too much like an episode. But yes, I do feel like that the show was well tailored for a live show, what with all the songs, but as much as I like Murray, he does the same thing he does on the TV show. I think Elmo now needing to undo the curse does help in the moral of responsibility, and how each character does get their big moment. Like Bert and Ernie singing about laundry, Grover and Baby Bear singing about quick service restraints, Big Bird and Rosita praising the power of songs, and even Cookie Monster doing a Let It Go inspired number before the actual song came to fruition.
No matter what the weather, there's something me like to do. Me use me imagination, pretending something new. Me imagine there no water, in rain clouds way up high. Me imagine there are cookie clouds, with cookies falling from the sky. It's raining cookies, cowabunga, it's raining cookies. Nom nom nom, oh nom nom nom. Me gonna stay out, me gonna stay outside, and keep me mouth open wide.
I love the inclusion of Hoots the Owl, since this was Kevin Clash's last show voicing Elmo and Hoots, and the stage debut of Murray Monster. I would change the understudies since it's weird to see Tully or Count as an understudy. Number 22, Big Bird Super Spectacular Totally Amateur Show. This show takes inspiration from an actual episode of the show, which I felt like this show did better than Can't Stop Singing because it doesn't feel like an actual episode. The show feels instead like a musical review with each character getting their own big production number. The show also features tons of obscure characters including the two-headed monster, which is one of the intriguing costume characters, Frazzle, Fred the Wonder Horse, and more. Number 21, Around the World. The Around the World theme is cool, but the concept would be explored a little bit later in the actual series and specials. It's a nice way to showcase different cultures while showcasing them in a comedic but respectful way, like Sing After Me where Grover and Cookie sing the song on the Alps, London where the honkers honk around Big Ben, Count Von Count's big Transylvania number. I do think the concept is really played out, but pretty okay. Also, I'm surprised they would give honkers a major role in the show considering for their future silent efforts. Now it's time for the shows I have mixed feelings about, kind of like the fine folks at Sesame Workshop felt about a certain part of the street that took place around the corner.
Around the corner, around the corner, around the corner, around the corner.
Number 20, Everyone Makes Music. Like Out of This World has a really cute story, but feels limited when it comes to location. Harry Frank Bill, Frank Oz, Carol Spinney, and Jerry Nelson voiced their characters together is satisfying, especially since this is their last show all together, with Jerry voicing until Elmo's green thumb, Frank Bill until can't stop singing, and Carol would stay until the STR gave up the rights. The music is fine, the original songs are probably some of the best, the way they incorporate the classic songs from the television show doesn't feel forced, except for the pinball number count. Monster Clubhouse makes the show special, but I prefer Honk, Bang Whistle and Crash, that way Prairie stays in the finale. Number 19, Big Bird's Sunny Day Kempit. The show's story is weak, the gang can't figure out where to count out. But that doesn't mean there aren't memorable moments the show includes. Like Snuffy packing up for camping, Bert singing Rubber Ducky while Ernie is pressured not to share his treasured back toy, Dancing Sheep, Snuffy appearing in a majority of the show, the only good Elmo's World segment in Sesame Street Live, and, of course, the two original songs. Telephone Talk is such a catchy opener and much better than Telephone Hour and Bye Bye Birdie, and, of course, A Beautiful Day with a Friend is an emotional ballad and its message about the best part of any day is spending time with your friends, because they'll be by your side regardless of whatever is in store for whatever day, and just when you think it's starting to get good, the day ends, but at the end of the day, you'll still have a friend. Oh god, I think I talked myself into liking this show. It's not the best Sesame Street Live show, but still a pretty solid end to a solid decade. Number 18, Missing Bird Mystery. It's a solid first show. I believe that the show was the groundwork for the CERT 1985 movie. It's a great show, nostalgia aside, and worked well on a storytelling level along with a Muppet-oriented cast. I love all the songs in the show. C is for Cookie is a fun roller disco. Transylvania Polka is a fun act one closer. I love how the show hates P.T. Barnum. I think that there's a couple of negatives of the show of the theme. There's not much TV show characters in favor of any team Muppets and original characters. Number 17, Save Our Street. It's a good show, especially since this is the only show Snuffy appears in as imaginary friend to Big Bird Face, considering he would become real a year after. But the show is pretty predictable. Its major political theme of voting is a really great introduction for kids to politics, but the main plot would be used in specials like Stars and Street Forever. But of course, there's tons have great songs from the show that would be included, like Sesame Street is the best this street where all the Muppets literally get roasted, except for Count and Big Bird for some reason, some characters dancing to the Beverly Hills Cop theme, I Stay Too Long at the Fair, The Big Heap of Trash, and, of course, Count's Haunted House Rock. Number 16, Elmo's Healthy Heroes. I think the original show did lay down the groundwork for what I think is one of the few good revival productions. Speaking of which, I like that Abby replaced Rosita and not Zoe, that way Prairie did get to stay and not be replaced by Baby Bear. I think the revival is a bit weaker, especially since Count isn't in the show as much as previously. Number 15, I was hard on the show at first glance, but looking back it's not that bad. As I pointed out in my review of the show, there's notably less characters and more humans. But I think the main problem with this show is that it's more human-oriented than Muppet-oriented. Casey and Caleb are really great lets, but the show's focused on them too much in Community Guildford. Also, Elmo came 25 minutes late into the show, which was nice and I really liked. Never do a thing like that ever again. There's a lot of fun moments in the show, like most of the musical numbers. Spanish Meme English Music Fun Number for Rosita, I Love Trash is a great piece for Oscar and a nice opportunity for him to teach the audience about recycling. C is for Cookie is the shortest but sweetest number paired with a hilarious Taylor Swift parody, The People in Your Neighborhood is a fun opening to the show and a great way for Fel to start the run with this iconic live touring brand, just like Magic, which is a fun song for Casey and Caleb joined by Elmo and Abby, I'm Cold which I thought was an original song, but when you dig a little deeper, it's a natural song from the TV show. A real deep cut if you're a classic fan of the TV show. Yes, I feel like we're all too hard on Left's Party, but it could have been worse. This was also the year Felt produced Into the Magic, which is the worst out of the currently touring Disney on Ice shows. Number 14, 1, 2, 3, Imagine. The show had a pretty interesting concept and a great cast of characters. I think that some of the best performances weren't even in 2009's remit. These include Skin Heat, a possible scene with Oscar in Antarctica, and Count's Imagination Rap. Traditional sets look best, and the curved MIDI stages look really great in this production. I think the 2002 version had a much better valance curtain, but I still associate that with the disappointment of a remit that happened in 2009 as well. I like that Bartley is in the show, I like the human character, I think In Your Imagination and I Don't Want to Live on the Moon were translated to the stage perfectly, and, of course, the covers and original songs. Dance with the Bears is King Akachi, and January 2nd, 2003, Imagine has the best opener. Number 13, When I Grow Up. Along with its cute storyline inspired by the Prairie Dawn pageant segments on Sesame Street, it features a fun and lively cast of characters that have great chemistry with each other. However, the only thing is that it heavily relies on a similar Sesame Street Live storyline, the 1990 Let's Play School where Big Bird can't decide on something for show and tell. The only thing different from that storyline is the incorporation of Elmo's similar problem where Elmo wants to be everything, which is much better here than the revival, because when we start Elmo wants to be a cowboy, but after seeing Grover's song he changes his mind, and so on and so forth. It's really good and translates well into the revival almost 14 years later. The Drive-In Number is one of my favorite Act 1 closers. Women Can Be is a nice song, but I think the funny Making My Way Downtown parody is better. Telly's Baseball Number is a silly salute to sports. Roxy Marie's Train Number is fun. Grunge appeared pressuring Oscar to dance to the Nutcracker's hilarious. Number 12, Silly Dancing. If I can describe the show, it's footloose but family friendly. While most of the shows focus on either Big Bird, Elmo, Abby, or Grover, it's good to focus on a different character once in a while. Oscar is no exception. Orman Stiles, who wrote the groundbreaking Sesame Street episode Divine Mr. Hooper, was able to write such a good show that stands out from any other Sesame Street show. The show's silly dancing theme is also accompanied by the silly craze called Jazzercise. So that's something. There's tons of interesting production numbers, including a rousing rendition of the Berlin Jump with tons of flips, trips, and a delightful way to close out Act 1. Alphabet Polka showcases some of the world's most famous dances, which is an equally as entertaining way to open up the second act. Cookie Monster's Gingerbread Town Fantasy is quite an endearing production number. Super Grover teaches Elmo how to be in a chorus line with a rousing rendition of I Can Do That, which is one of the best songs Sesame Street Live has ever parodied. Number 11, Big Bird Sesame Street Story. First of all, if you want to see how Sesame Street actually became a TV show, check out Street Gang, which explains the show's creation. But honestly, I think this is just a fun in-universe explanation on how the show was created through the Muppets, kinda like how the original Muppet movie showed how the Muppets met for the first time. The songs are so much fun, with the place where they make the TV shows is easily the show's best standout number, especially with its wonderful cover of the song Kids from Bye Bye Birdie. I've grown soft towards the Elmo's new shoes line throughout the show, considering it's one of the funniest. Elmo bragging about his air-fueled sneakers and the development of Big Bird's reaction throughout the entire show is pretty hilarious to watch unfold. In fact, it is so good that I had to incorporate it into Birdie and the Beast. And now for the moment, we've all been waiting for the top 10. Number 10, Where's the Birdie? Where's the Birdie? Yes, surprisingly a remand featuring the inclusion of Elmo made the top 10. I can't believe it. I think adding Elmo, again, was a good idea to keep the show relevant. But compared to something like the January 2nd, 2003, Imagine where a majority of its original charm is taken away to feel more corporate, I must commend the production on using the philosophy, revival should add instead of take away, which is a step up from 1991's Big Bird and the ABC's and Better Than Elmo Makes Music, When Elmo Grows Up, and other revivals. Elmo now has the role of a newspaper boy, along with Cookie Monster the same year the Newsies film came out, and the show gets newer backdrops for different scenes. The Birdlin Jump is an equally as charming Act 1 closer, and Let's Party 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 is a great finale composed by the Don Harper. Number 9, Make a New Friend. By far, one of the better shows of the 2010s, I would have given the show a higher ranking if Big Bird had more to distance. The focus was more on the older Muppets like Count, Bert, Ernie, Cookie, Grover as opposed to Elmo, Zoe, Rosita, Abby, etc. Also Lulu is back from obscurity and is medium understudy once again. Yay! Number 8, Big Bird and the Axe. Dear God, this is the one of the cutest stories Sesame Street Live has ever done. It's about this Martian named T.T. who has to fix her spaceship to get back to her home planet of Crayon with all the Muppets pitching in. All the while they learn about Crayon and its culture, digging into the Sesame Street Live lore. I think it's such a fun show, the songs are fun, the characters are fun, Bert sings his hip to be square, Count's Act 1 Closer is such a charming number, and I think it's still a solid show even with Elmo and Snuffy's place in 1993. Number 7, Sleeping Birdie. I have a soft spot for fairy tales, and this is no exception. This show is also a sequel to another Sesame Street Live show, Big Bird and the ABCs, which introduced Tee Hee and the planet Krayon. While poking fun at some of the common tropes of fairy tales, they really did a great job exploring more of the planet crayon lore while parodying a good old fairy tale. I also really enjoy the B-plot of the show being Oscar and Brumjilla trying to get the characters to stop writing the title story through thievery, bribery, and some other third thing. The music is top-notch, and some of the songs in the show are full proof of that. Biggest Noise on Sesame Street is a charming way to open up the second act for the Birds' Is It Fun ensemble number for the cast where Big Bird, Bert, the Yellow Queen, and Ernie show off some of their favorite bird moves. Fuzzy and Blue and Red is a vaudeville showstopper with in terms of choreography, lighting, and orchestrations. Sunny Days is a fun way to close out the story, especially since the main theme is mixed with a peppermint twist. Number 6, Make Your Magic. Before we get started, I would like to point out that Elmo's green thumb and can't stop singing showcase magic in a way that it can't be messed around with nilly-willy, and Bofell shows uses it as an advantage disregarding any mistakes. Anyways, this is probably one of the best shows Feld Entertainment has done so far. Chef Gengar's debut is surely one to remember, and this is the most prominent role Count Von Count has had since the 1990s. The storyline is good and gives the characters plenty to do, and incorporates pretty unique illusions along with Sesame Street's trademark life lessons. Elmo's storyline is really inspiring and the set is gorgeous. The costumes are gorgeous. The orchestrations, not as strong as previous shows, but the soundtrack is quite memorable when we talk about song selection. I would have added in Believe in Yourself instead of Don't Give Up or BFF, but maybe that's just my lame personal preference. I literally prefer the Sunny Day Camping over the Elmo Makes Music Show, which is a controversial opinion, but now let's move on. Number 5, Elmo's Coloring Book. This show garners the best set design of any Sesame Street live show ever. It looks like a paint palette with pink and steppists, along with a light arch for Professor Art's workshop, and the stylized Sesame Street looks amazing. The storyline is very strong here, and I think that the songs in the show are just as fun. Mix It Up is a definite showstopper, and the opener slash closer My Favorite Color is a wholesome theme song. The adaptations have Pong Bang Whistle and Crash and Teletut are really well orchestrated, and the showcase of the primary colors shows off a lot of nice character moments and ensemble routines. I think the 2004 version isn't as good since Rosita doesn't have her wings and Prairie Dawn doesn't speak in this version, but still a fun show. Number 4, Super Grover Ready for Action. The lesson in healthcare, the prominent appearances of Prairie Dawn, Rocco, it's awesome, and a nice return to form for Sesame Street Live after the two revivals and two staged episodes that came before. While Elmo and friends do play a major role in the show, it's really Super Grover who takes over the leading role, and boy oh boy, does he sure love the show well. His storyline of finding his supers is hilarious but sad at the same time, especially since a super part of me which was written for the show showed Super Grover's sensitive side, which really worth it once Super Grover flies in an incredible way towards the end of the show. And since I saw the 2012 version in person, I can confirm that it looks just as good in person, or even better. Number 3, Let's Play School. First of all, modern jukebox musicals suck. Take for instance a musical and Juliet, they just have popular songs for the sake of popular songs. The only good ones are Mamma Mia, Footloose, and Leader of the Pack, the Ellie Greenwich Story, which my high school performed. But there is one exception to the jukebox musical rule where it is truly superior. That, my friends, is Let's Play School. A majority of the songs do come from pre-existing songs, but they work well with the show's theme of playing school. Like I Only Want to Be With You is a spelling lesson about Q. Okay. And you, hand jive being reworked into a lesson about crossing guards and safety signs, down on the corner being Cookie Monster's firefighter demonstration, the music goes around being a nice little demonstration at music. And of course, Come On and Count being a parody of Shout and the Blues Brothers to help teach counting. It's awesome. And in addition to the fun parody songs, we also got some original songs including Show and Tell. For the aforementioned Show and Tell segment, Listen to Your Heart, a song Prairie sings to Big Bird, Good Friends, which was Big Bird's rousing salute to friendship. Also, I really like this show. It has a cute storyline based on the Professor Grover skits, plus the school theme works really well. Big Bird and Prairie having starring roles in this day and age of SSL are rare, but I'm very happy they do. The only thing I would change is give some more for the other characters to do, like Elmo or Barkley, since Bert and Bernie score the most numbers in the show. Number 2, Elmo's Green Thumb. The show's storyline puts Sesame Street Live in a new point of view and takes us away from the street setting into a more garden-esque setting. Its parody of Honey, I Shrunk the Kids makes a good storyline and a great way to teach children about the environment and how to take care of it, and the B-plot in the garden with Big Bert, Ernie, Cookie, and the others waiting for the cast to get back is equally as entertaining and filled with equally as memorable moments and lessons Sesame Street is known for. Overall, a strong message and fun storyline. Honestly, Let's Be Friends is a masterpiece in all aspects. The lighting, the character inclusion, the music, it's all wonderful. I think this show serves as a great debut for Zoli, and a great warm welcome back to Snuffleupagus to any Sesame Street lit production. And I think the storyline was very intriguing and helps us understand that inclusion doesn't mean taking seats away, but adding more seats to the table. You could have a cleaner room, a less frightening haircut, or a bigger and better circus. Inclusion is very important, and is a very important message to promote. And I think the show does a great job at showcasing the message in a way that is not only memorable, but also fun. The music is Don Harper at his peak and has tons of memorable production numbers, and every character with the exception of Baby Bear gets something to do. Which does start each act, Snuffy ends each act with a subplot about him and Big Bird planning to go to the circus, with him also joining the friendship club in the process. Elmo and Zoe are fun labs, and I think this show is perfect in every way. What did I like? First point, I like that the original version of each show, Big Bird was the first character to appear, and before anyone asks, Abby and Grover were added later in Left's Party. Because essentially he was the one who started the whole thing. Kind of like how Disney on Ice starts with Mickey and Minnie, Sesame Street Live should always start with Big Bird as a reminder that he's been there since the beginning. Elmo should be second, because he's popular. Second, and most important point, I really like that these newer shows include more interactivity than usual. This is a children's live show, and is obviously required to interact with the audience. Feld really takes it up a notch by having several moments dedicated to audience interaction, including some fun moments where guests can play a bird call game with Big Bird, help Oscar sort his recyclables and trash, sing along with Cookie Monster, and, of course, count with the count. I think Feld Entertainment got a hold of some Sesame Street live traditions or secrets from BE star, Super Grover only being in one scene and the rest of the show he's Grover, speaking at which I love the fact that Grover's role is pretty prominent throughout the show, and good job on Feld continuing the tradition of character announcements, with Grover taking the mantle. Also, the set is an homage to the classic sets by BE star from the 1980s, last seen in Sesame Street Story. Despite the lack of the chaser lights, I think it's great that they paid homage to the set. Overall, Sesame Street Live had a good run, and hopefully our favorite furry friends, and, of course, the one and only Count Von Count, will get a chance to shine on stages and arenas across the nation once again and eventually at one point of time.
See you soon, everyone!
Now scram!